Brother Jeremy going two?
Yeah.
Yeah. Two girls, two boys. And all kids, when you get done, call me out the side and I'll pick up that children.
What's your name?
You kid.
Hey, you don't get snow. Have Miss Hazel taking pictures for us. You don't feel good today. Pray for you. All right. Are y'all looking, fellas? Can you see all of them?
Y'all.
Can y'all see ones over here? Look over here. Look over here.
Yeah.
All right, we got two girls.
Right here.
Come on.
Right here.
All right, come here, sweetheart. You stand with me. And, hold on. No, this way, man. We'll take the turn here. Oh, good. Okay, two boys. Oh, y'all got it?
Brothers.
Your brothers.
Amen. All right. Let's give them all a hand this morning. All right. The teacher, you stay here. Amen. This is a $100,000 gift card. Minus. Give me a mic. Amen. 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 Now, tell it by your name.
Lillian.
Lillian, and who's most of you right?
Brother Jerry.
You like Brother Jerry?
Yeah.
Why do you like?
He's a great person because he helps us.
Amen. Thank you, God. Here's your gift card. Let's give her a hand for the first time. You know I'm a little nervous by talking to you, don't you? Come on up and walk up here. Come on, come right here. Tell me your name.
Josh.
Oh, we got several.
Yeah.
All right, tell me.
Josh.
And Josh, what bus are you riding?
Jerry's.
Jerry's. And what is it about what Jerry you like?
Cool.
He's cool. Y'all don't know if that would work, right, Brother Jerry? How long have you been riding bus? It's been a long time?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Now, Hurricanes, do you play for them? You don't? Do you play football? All right. Anyway, answer, gift card, look. Go buy your girlfriend something. All right. Okay.
Jacob.
Jacob, you're right. I guess Brother Jerry's boss. Can you think of anything like real besides cool to say about Brother Jerry?
He's helpful.
He's helpful. Thank you very much. Jerry, you're helpful. I believe that more than cool. All right. How long have you been riding bus? You and your brother been riding at the same time? All right. How you go, buddy? God bless your heart. Come here. Because look, I got money. That's candy, right? Tell them what your name is. This is Sarah. And we see, look, and Sarah's got on, what is that, East? Now, East, is that some high school here? East what? Elementary. All right. Now you get to ride on the bus too, don't you? Get to do stuff sometimes. And they picked you across that outfit, I guess. And who do you like? Do you think Brother Jerry's cool? That's the way I feel too, baby. Here. Jerry, and all right, sounds good. Amen. Brother Alex, 39 today. Hallelujah, son. Keep working hard. Wonderful. Okay, Brother John's going to come each Sunday this week, this month, and we're going to be at 12:15 services, and you'll be okay. You won't get too much church, but each Sunday we're going to have somebody come up and give you a little word of testimony. The last Sunday month, we're going to have a group of young people sing for you that are off our buses, plus some testimonies. But Brother John has been here since age what, Brother John? 10 years old, you're 16? 17. And won't Brother John come up, share a word about the bus ministry, what it means to him. Brother John, you come up. This mic right here, Brother.
First of all, I just want to thank God for saving me. I made a couple of false professions, you know, when I was younger, didn't really understand it. I just thank God that he didn't give up on me. He could have let me go to hell off of those two false hopes, but I'm thankful that, you know, he didn't let me. I'm thankful that when we went up to the Bible Mountain, I didn't go up the mountain expecting to get saved, but I'm sure glad I come down. I remember when I was younger, Brother Jerry, every Saturday, come knocking on the door, you know, and inviting us to church and trying to get us to come to church. And, you know, kind of been to church here and there when I was growing up with my grandparents and mom. A lot of people took me here and there, but never really got a hold of me until Brother Jerry come. And I saw his persistence and his dedication to making sure he was there every Saturday. He was there every Sunday. Now Sunday mornings he'd have to wait on me because, you know, when he'd blow the horn, that would be my wake-up call. And I just remember from what I was then to what I am now, you know, there's been so much of a change. I remember just from pictures and actually remembering I had long hair, mullet, I guess is what you'd call it. But I remember nobody looked down on me because of that, you know, nobody looked down on me because of my financial situation, or nobody looked down on me because I wasn't as, you know, nicely dressed as they were. You know, everybody, they loved me. And, you know, I'm thankful for what the bus ministry was. And then I remember I got saved, and Brother Jerry and Miss Janet was all the time telling me, you know, on the bus, John, you're going to be a bus worker one day. And I'd tell them, no, you just be quiet. Don't tell me that. But I did, you know. Brother Johnny actually invited me to go with him, and I got started visiting with him on his bus route and 2 or 3 years ago now. Then, you know, slowly but surely, God began to burden my heart about people, about lost people, and then God called me to preach, but I really don't believe he could have called me to preach if I wouldn't have started working on the bus ministry and got that burden for people that I did. And, you know, I thank God that he allows me to work on the bus ministry. You know, some people look at it as a burden to have to give up their Saturday morning and most of their Sunday, but I know I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for the bus ministry. And I love the opportunity to work in it, and I love everything about it.
Amen. I believe one of the most biblical ministries any church could ever have is a bus ministry. I've got my vote for that. I believe that. Brother Harry, you have a song for us today.
Today is our pastor's 10th anniversary. I'm sure y'all wish you happy anniversary. We're going to be celebrating on the 21st. Don't forget that. Don't forget what I talked to you about. It's a secret. I made
don't sing it. I like that. Amen. Let's stand together. Luke chapter number 14, verse number 16, please. Luke chapter number 14, verse number 16. And we'll hear just a moment the word of God. I'm conscious of the time. I won't be long. But I do want to take time this week. I thank God for my bus children and adults and all of them that come. And we're going to be special to them this week. Say amen.
Amen.
Time for that. I want to preach this morning from Luke chapter 14, verse number 16. The Bible said, "Then said he unto him, A certain man made a great supper and bade many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, Come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuse. The first one said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs go and see it." You can tell these excuses were just made up lies. You're not going to buy a piece of ground and not go see it. "I pray thee, have me excused. Another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray, have me excused." The other guy might have been telling the truth. Another said, "I have married a wife, therefore I cannot come." So that servant came and showed his lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to the servant, "Go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city, and bring in hither the poor and the maimed and the halt and the blind." The servant said, "Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, yet there is room." The Lord said unto the servant, "Go out into the highways and hedges, and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say unto you that none of these men, those men which were bidden, shall taste of my supper." Years ago, I read a message, a book, Brother Dermot, in the service. Don't you let me forget Life Change Day. Don't let me forget it. I need you to announce it. Years ago, I read a book. It was written by a great man of God in fundamentalism. The title of the book is the title of my message today. It has nothing to do with this book. It was just the title of a book that I read. The book was entitled Highways, Hedges, and Buses. It's a great book written by a great man of God. And the burden that we are to have as children of God to reach people that are lost without Christ. And let me say this, the church is not here for entertainment. It is not here for suppers. It is not here for all the other stuff. The purpose of the church is to win sinners to Christ, get them saved, and a part of the family of God. You believe that this morning? I believe if anything is biblical today, I believe it is biblical to win the lost to Christ.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
You can be seated this morning. I want to, for just a few moments this morning, to take this chapter of the Word of God, these verses that I've read, and I want this morning for a few moments to go through this story just a little bit. And I trust today we'll get the gist of what's going on here. And I want everyone, if you would, to give me your undivided attention. And I think all of us can sit in an hour and 15 minute service and stay attentive to what we're hearing. And I want you today to give your attention this morning to the subject that I'm going to preach. This morning, as I think about highways, hedges, and buses, I think about the ministry of reaching the lost world for Christ. I think about, at my age of 48 years old, what am I doing for God? 10 years that I've been here. 10 years that God's allowed me to pastor this church. Dr. Cole and I were discussing that. He's celebrating 10 years in Canaan today. And I was thinking about what we've seen God do. The buildings that we've seen God allow us to build, the growth of the church, the many that have been baptized and saved. And I realized that in this time in my life, this is an important time for my life. This is a time that if I'm going to get the work done, God's called me to do, that we need to be busy in doing the work church that has a heart for sinners. If we're a church that doesn't have a heart for sinners, then we're a church that's missing what God wants us to do. Several things. Look back with me if you would in Luke 14. I want you to see in Luke 14, first of all, the desire of the Savior. The desire of the Savior. What a great picture here in the Word of God of what our Lord's desire is. The Bible says in verse 9, number 16 and 17, a certain man made a great supper and bade many, and sent his servant at supper time and said to them, were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. I'll give you a parallel scripture to that verse, and that verse is 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Let me say, the desire of our Savior today is for everybody in this building to be saved by the grace of God. God doesn't want anybody in this building today to die lost and end up in the devil's hell. Aren't you glad this morning for a whosoever will gospel? Aren't you glad this morning that one day God stopped by where you were and he stopped by your life and he dealt with your sin and he showed you the Savior and you got saved by the grace of God? I'm glad it didn't matter if you were from a mill town like I was or if you're from Broadway or if you're from Wall Street. It does not matter. The point is Jesus died for everybody, and I'm glad that he did, and I preach and believe a whosoever will gospel. Say amen. Amen. You know what that says today? That says that the desire of the Savior is for everybody in this building to be saved. You know what that means to you, dear friend? That means Jesus died for you. That means Jesus loves you. Yes, you. That means Jesus gave his life for you. You say, but preacher, you don't know my life. Preacher, you don't know the way I live. Preacher, you don't understand where I come from. Can I say this to you today? I'm telling you, Jesus died for everybody so that everybody could be saved. And here is this great supper's being prepared, and the picture of the end time, and the picture of one day what God's going to do with us. You see the desire of the Savior. Boy, I'm so glad Jesus loves sinners. I was preaching to a church this week, and I'll be honest with you, I told them this. I'm so tired of going in fundamental Baptist churches, and everybody act like they're doing God a favor for being there. And everybody act like they're just putting in their time, and they're half bored, and they can't wait to get out, and can't wait to go about the world, and get more excited about games and programs. Hey, can I say something to you today? All of us need to step back and realize that we'd all be on our way to hell. None of us would be saved. That the greatest joy in all of the world is to be a born-again Christian, saved by the grace of God, and we ought to never get over the fact that God saved us. Amen. How many of you glad this morning God saved you? I changed your life. That's the desire of the Savior. Hey, listen to me. Everybody listen. If you're here today and you can't pillow your head tonight and know that you go to heaven, the desire of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is that you would know Him. Is that He would be a part of your life. He died for you and He loves you. Secondly, I want you to look, if you would, at the decision of the sinner. The Bible says here in this passage, they begin to make excuse. I won't go through that again. I read it to you a while ago. But one talked about his land, and another talked about his ox, and another talked about his life. In other words, they began to make excuse. Friend, listen, I am convinced that God will not force himself on anybody. I believe with all my heart. I do not listen. I am so tired of this movement today that tries to talk about some going to heaven, some going to hell. This predestination cry. Let me tell you today, friend, I believe with all my heart it is a whosoever will gospel, but I also believe with all my heart that God will not force himself on anybody. He'll give you the opportunity. He'll deal with your heart. He'll give you the invitation, but you must be born again. And listen, friend, when God deals with your heart, you must surrender to him.
That's right.
Amen. One lady told me one time, and she wasn't even, she don't have Bible for this. Sometimes people think they're smart, but there's no Bible for this. A lady told me one time, she said, I couldn't help but get saved. I had no choice. I said, that's a lie, the pits of hell. That's a lie, the pits of hell. Hey, I can show you Jesus by the well in John 4. There's a woman there
And Jesus said, if you knew this water, and that lady said, give me this water, she could have left with her water pot. She didn't have to receive that water. She didn't have to take that water. Jesus didn't force that water down her throat. But thank God one day I came thirsty, and I came hungry, and I had a desire that something had to be better in my life. And I got a good drink from another world, and I got a good fountain drink from another world, and I'll never be the same. Thank God I'm glad we can drink from Emmanuel's veins. Amen.
Oh, yes. So I want you to see in this passage of the Word of God, how many of you signs you're saved, they say amen. How many of you glad you're saved, and they say amen. How many of you glad for that day God reached down where you were? How many of you glad God changed your life? How many of you glad God loved you so much that He was willing to die and send His own Son? Let's not ever get over that. Let's say hip, hip, hooray. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I'm glad God saved me. Amen. Oh, yes, I'm more excited about being saved now than I've ever been since I've been saved. God for that. The desire of the Savior. Secondly, the decision of the sinner. If you're sitting here today and you don't know Christ, don't make the wrong decision. Don't leave here without God. Leave here lost. Number three, if you would please, I want you to see the duty of the servant. I believe that's where all of us come in. Notice what the Bible says, if you would, in Luke 14:21. So the servant came and shewed his Lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to the servant, go out quickly to the streets and the lanes of the city and bring in hither the poor and the maimed and the halt and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded. And I like this next phrase. And yet there is room. Hallelujah. The duty of the servant. Everybody listen to me. Listen to me this morning. I've never felt the urgency in my ministry as I do now. And I'm talking about right here on this road. I really feel like God's laid a great open door before us. I really feel like this is our time, our opportunity. Well, I'm so excited to see what God's doing here. The souls being saved, people being baptized, lives being changed. I'm not going to let men sway me. I'm not going to be discouraged by the faithfulness or unfaithfulness of men. I'm going to do what God called me to do. But I want you to understand something with all my heart. It is the duty of every single one of you in this building to go into the highways and hedges and compel people to come. It is your duty to tell people about Christ. It is more important for you to tell people about Christ than to do anything else. You are required in the Bible to go share the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is not just a bus captain's job. It is not just your pastor's job. It is not just a deacon's job. It is not just Brother Paquette and the Spanish church's job. It is everybody's responsibility to take the gospel and to share with others on what Christ has done for you. But most of you sitting here this morning will never invite anyone to the supper. And that's sad. Churches across our country can be filled to capacity because sinners are longing for something. And it's our job and our duty. The servant said, I've done what you asked. The servant said, I went, Lord, and I've done what you wanted me to do. I went and I've shared the gospel. I went and I've told him to come to the king's table. I went and said, there's a great supper and prayer. You and I need to be faithful to our duty of what God has called us to do. There's the duty of the servant here in this chapter of the Word of God. You know what? Many mornings I come over early. And when I come over early, in my truck or car, I always meet one or two or three of our buses leaving. They're leaving before some of you get up in the morning. They're leaving before some of you can get your teeth brushed and eat your breakfast. They're already out. Some of them on Saturday are already out there and they're knocking on doors somewhere and inviting someone to Christ. And you know what? I think about many times when I ride in on Sunday morning, that's my heroes. That's the people I couldn't do without. We couldn't have the ministry. John would have never been saved. And others on this front row, and Matt and others would have never been saved if somebody hadn't reached out and somebody hadn't loved them and somebody hadn't done what they were required to do. Amen. But listen to me. Tomorrow you'll go to work. Some of you tomorrow will go somewhere tomorrow where people don't know Christ. They're dying without God and they have no hope. And because you're a little bashful or because you feel like, well, I don't want to bother anybody.
I would hate one day for people to stand at the judgment of God and me be in the grandstand and somebody were to scream at me, why didn't you ever tell me? Why didn't you ever share Christ with me? You worked with me every day. You were around my life every day. Well, I was afraid you might have got upset. I'm afraid you might have not liked it. It doesn't matter, friend. God didn't tell us to do that. We can love people, but we must share with them what God did for us. We must share the gospel. If there's anything fundamental churches are failing in, it's amazing to me. You go in a whole lot of churches and camp meetings today, well, you get up and talk about the way people dress and they'll shout you out. You get up talking about haircuts and they'll shout you out. You get up talking about standard and they'll shout you out. And I'm all for doing right. But I'm telling you what, nothing ought to excite us more. Nothing ought to make us shout more. Nothing ought to make us rejoice more than the fact that we can go share the gospel and tell others about Christ and they can be born again and saved by the grace of God. Can I get an amen? Absolutely. The desire of the Savior is that no one would perish. If you're here today, that's God's desire. The decision of the sinner. The sinner says, no, I will make excuses. I'm not interested. The duty of the servant is for you and I to go tell. Thank God somebody did tell Brother John. Somebody did tell Brother Matt. Somebody did tell these young people this morning how to be saved. Somebody did tell Miss Sharon. Somebody did tell Brother Joe. Somebody did tell these people about Christ. About what he could do in their life. And I got news for you, friend. You look at me. Jesus died for everybody.
Amen.
Yes. I'll tell you right now, when you come on this property, there are no special people.
Right.
There nobody goes here better.
Amen.
You didn't walk in here better than anybody else.
Right.
You walked in here, or you want to be in hell burning in the charred walls of the damned. You're not good in yourself. We are what we are by the good grace of God. And hallelujah, I'm so glad this morning. Lord, I feel the Holy Ghost stir my soul.
Yes, sir.
Number four, not only is there the desire of our Savior, the decision of our sinner, the duty of the servant, but number four, there's the development of the sanctuary. How do you build a church? Oh, you know how we build them today, don't you? A cup of coffee and donut.
Yeah, yep.
Right.
Praise band.
Right.
That's right. Come to our church, you dress down.
Yep.
You don't have to worry about being, if you're a member, you don't have to worry about doing right. We try to draw crowds. All we're doing is like a dead possum. We're just swelling, but we're still dead.
Right.
Amen. Amen. But I'm going to tell you this. I believe with all my heart, you listen to me this morning, I believe with all my heart, the way to build a church is the way we're doing it in Calvary.
Amen.
That's right. As John testified, God just didn't bring Brother John here just to be saved. God brought John here to call him to preach. God brought John here to work on the bus. God brought John here to win others to Christ. Do you understand? You know how church grows? People tell you all the time, well, you can't build church on buses because you've got to have some people in church that got money, they can give, do all that. You know what I saw a long time ago? I figured God's got the treasury in control. As a matter of fact, if a lot of you quit giving 3%, give what you ought to give, we would have a problem with that anyway. And don't worry, because not only is this bus month, it's also stewardship month. And I have been doing a little bit of studying. Amen. I want you to understand the development of the sanctuary. How do we build a church? Let me tell you something. For the most part, this road here would be empty. Or maybe one exception or two would be empty, if not for the bus ministry. For the most part, this road right here, except for a few, would be empty. Next one would be, do you understand what I'm saying? You're saying, how do you build a church? How do you build a church? You build a church 100% with the gospel of Jesus Christ. You tell other people about the Lord. Let God take care of the rest of it. That's good preaching, Pastor. I get so tired today. Listen, I travel so much and I get so tired of going to places that don't have a heart for people. It bothers me. God put us here to have a heart for people.
Amen.
Do you understand?
Right.
God put us here to have a heart for people. appreciate what others do. I don't cross my T and dot my I like everybody else does. But my doctor and her family, I appreciate the fact they're not independent Baptists. You know what I appreciate about them? They have a heart to want to reach people. They want to see people get saved. And whether they're going to dot their I cross their T like me or not, it's not my deal. They're not part of my church. But I'm going to tell you this. I'm glad that some people have a heart to win others to Christ and want to see them get saved.
Amen.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Independent Baptist Church sometimes sitting on the corner all day screaming about how everybody else is wrong and they're right, but they don't even get outside their doors to go tell anybody else about Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I never want to pastor a church where sinners are not welcome.
Amen.
I never want to pastor a church where the lame and the halt and the blind and the maimed are not welcome.
That's right.
I want to pastor a church where everybody walks through that door special. Everybody walks through that church door means something. Say amen. Oh, listen. Hey, I want to win. I want to win the millionaire. I want to win the millionaire to God. And I want them to tithe. Amen. But I also want to win that little kid that's got dirt on their shoes and don't have a clean thing in the house and don't know where they're going to eat next. So I want to win that child just as well. And they're just as important to me. Let me give you this finally this morning. The desire of the Savior is that everybody be saved. The decision of the sinner is that, oh no, 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 not today. I'm busy, I don't have time. The duty of the servant is, go tell them. The development of the sanctuary is how we build our church. Highways, hedges, and buses. Highways and hedges is us going, buses is them going. And then there's the demise of the stubborn. In Luke 14:24, here's what he said. For I say unto you, that none of those men which were bidden shall taste of my supper. You know what he said? He said, everybody just said no. The demise. Well, everybody listen this morning. Once you get a hold of what I'm getting ready to say. I believe with all my heart that every person gets an opportunity to be saved. I believe that the only way you can be saved is that God deals with you. God calls you. God deals with you. I do not believe anybody can ever get saved just when they want to.
That's right.
I believe there must be a time where the Holy Ghost deals with the sinner. That sinner is under conviction. That sinner realizes their loss, and that sinner comes to Christ.
Amen.
But I also believe this. God does not have to give you more than an opportunity. So that means to me that if you're sitting in here today and you don't know right now if you died, you go to heaven, and God's dealing with your heart and you know in your heart that God's dealing with your heart and you need to be saved, I cannot promise you that that happens again tomorrow.
Right.
I cannot promise you that that happens again next week. But I can promise you that if God's dealing with you today, today is the day of salvation.
That's right.
I want to ask some others at Calvary to do me a favor. Don't you want to be a part of the most exciting church in Statesville, North Carolina? Don't you want to be a part of a church where people say, maybe we need to go to that area and see the people getting saved and lives being changed and heart being? You want to be a part of that? I'm going to tell you what you ought to do today. You ought to get up here on an altar if there's enough room for you around this side of these walls. You ought to get on your knees and here's what you ought to pray. Lord, help me to be that servant that's willing to tell somebody else what Christ did for me. It's a shame. I don't want to be mean this morning. It's a shame that most of you have never talked to anybody about Jesus. That's a shame. You say, preacher, that's not fair. Now, I just don't have no personality. I'm introverted. The easiest thing I do is up here. When I knock on the door on visitation or I talk to somebody I don't know, it's everything. I have to force myself to talk to people I don't know. That's my why. I'm introverted. For me to knock on the door on a cold call, on a visitation I'm sat, it's different for me. I am way not comfortable with that. But I ask the Holy Ghost to help me do what's right. And then I just go do what God wants me to do. You know what I've learned? It's not me anyway. It's Him.
Amen.
Listen, when I'm up in the mountains like this week, when I'm
wherever I'm at, I talk to people about Christ. I'll say, boy, I'm glad I'm saved. Or, I don't do it mean. I don't do it judgmentally. I don't look at them and say, boy, you already did. No. I just want them to know what Jesus did for me. Somebody say amen. I want them to know what Jesus did for me.
Amen.
Amen. Now this morning, there's a supper. There's a day coming. The Father sent His servant. He's calling. But there will come a time God cuts that off. There will come a time that's over. I'll tell you what we better do. We get better, get more serious about the things of God, people going to heaven and hell, than we are about lost up in this world. Doesn't matter. That's honest true. Honest true. I was up this week in my camper by myself at church, and I got a burden about several things. God knows what they are, but God just burdened me. Burdened about several things. I know the Lord's put that burden on me. Won't you listen to me? It may not mean much today because mama's living. Daddy's living. Your co-worker's there. Your brother's sister's living. But I want you to understand, it may not always be the case. And wouldn't it be a shame one day for them to go into eternity and you never one time share with them what Christ did for you? I just don't like to preach at people. I'm not talking about preaching to anybody. I'm talking about, if nothing else, just look at them and say, I just want to tell you I love Jesus for what He did for me. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. It's not just our missionary's responsibility. It's everybody's.